Me, I learned the hard way. Okay? I learned the hard way. Being a practitioner is one thing. Being business is something altogether different. Okay? I left a really well-paid job in football to do what I do. My goal was to make a difference in the world, still is now. It was never because I thought I had the grandest plans of, from a financial point of view. I came from a place here, I felt I could do more. I loved the game, I felt privileged to work at the highest level in the game, although I felt there was more to me. I spent lifelong learning, I came from a poor background. My mum was ill, my dad didn't usually don't work, meant I had to go work in a factory at 15 to help support the family as well. And it was tough, going to school and working, it wasn't easy. So I felt guilty leaving a well-paid job to go off on this vision I had. For me, it was about putting a dent in the universe, doing something out of the ordinary. And I started working with young people to begin with, and that sort of widened the radar. I had lots of experience. What I didn't have is the business mind. I was great at what I did. I won coaching awards. I'd done so many courses, so many qualifications. I put so much time and effort. I paid for university out of my own pocket. I paid all these courses. I wasn't that academic at school, and I worked really hard to get to where I was. Where I was going wrong was the business acronym. I would have footballers, for example, who were making really, really big money come and see me for sessions. I wouldn't even charge them. That's truth be told. The reason being, I felt like a paternal figure to some of them because I saw them so high. I thought, I'm not going to charge them. I feel guilty. I don't feel right charging them. But they didn't know what I was going through because I'd worked for businesses and increased value for them. And the invoices weren't coming. So I'd do the work and then I'd be chasing invoices. I'd do work and help people with anxiety, many, many different things. And they'd send me emails saying, great, I feel better, I've got the job, and blah, blah, blah. And I thought, wow, why am I struggling? And that for me made me realize that you can be the best personal trainer, the best therapist, the best coach, the best whatever you do in the world. It don't make a difference from the point of view if you're not got that sort of business acronym. I never had a business acronym because growing up for me, money was this sort of evil type thing in the sense that we were really working class. You know, salt of the earth people I grew up around, money was this sort of thing that they have over there. We're not them. I used to work in a factory and I used to have dreams of competing in sport and traveling around the world. So we don't do that here, Jim. Not your place. And I've been drunk in my head for years. Okay? And I say that because the basis for me, I nearly found myself bankrupt. And I thought, this is wrong. I've got children, but they're not going to go through what I went through growing up. They're not going to be working in factory like I was after school and on weekends to make ends meet. It's not going to happen. And I'm not going to go back into working for a company or an organization. I've got plenty of offers, by the way, because I'm looking at the big picture. Okay, so the rich people, I had to get my head around all this. And what I did, I started studying people who are successful, and I found my own place. I found a sliding scale. Because I still, and my passion was to help young people, and sometimes you go to schools, and the funding's not easy, and I thought, well, by the time I get any funding to go to school, it could be forever, and I want to go in and help them. So I realized, okay, I have a sliding scale. And the corporate, and I make no secret, the corporate I can charge, and I enjoy working in the corporate sector and sport and that sort of stuff as well, but that's the way I roll. And there's people who struggle and to pay for my services, and I feel comfortable then paying something for it, to value me. Know your worth. It's really important you know your worth. The reason I say know your worth is because how price do you put on? What price do I put on a session someone pays for me if they get the job, if they get the presentation, if they reduce the anxiety, if they go on and score 20 goals a season, if they get a new contract? What value? No one's ever emailed me back saying, Jim, you know what? I've got a new contract for a professional football team. I've just got this job. I've just improved my life. Here's a bit of commission. It doesn't happen. And I don't want it either. And I'm not saying that their success is down to me. That's not the case. I've always said that when people give me credit, it's not down to me. I just facilitate. And I say, why do I need you then? You facilitate. Like a driving instructor. You can drive on your own, but you can facilitate. She can facilitate. That's what I see myself. It's not an ego boost. Oh, I've done this to this person. No. And I'm happy that people give me sort of praise. It's nice. But that relation, I can take or leave it. It's fine. I'm okay. And for me, go to the energy you want to be. And I think hearing Silva talk this morning, and it really resonated. Because no matter how hard it was for me, I would always be the energy. And even when I was struggling and couldn't afford to put petrol in the car, and driving a banger that would break down in the middle of the highway, I still go into that corporation buzzing. Even when I'd go to the professional football club and park my old 200-pound banger two blocks away and walk in, I'd still go in there buzzing. I still have that. Be the energy. If you're a parent and you want to motivate your children, go to the energy. If you're a teacher, go to the energy. That's the key for me. And think now, these days, what's your X factor? Now, unique selling point is gone. Now, it's about you. What is your X factor? For many, many years, I was someone that wasn't the way I felt was me to be. And I made some changes. I had this realization that I'm going to play to my strength now. And I'm not going to be for everybody, and I'm fine with that. So I set my stall out, and I said, you know what? I'm not going to be for everybody, but I know I'm going to do a lot of good in this world. So I went for the intention, and I decided to just change and just really come from a place within. That's not to say I wasn't coming from a place within all those years ago. I just felt I needed to go an extra mile to really change it up a bit, freshen it up. And that's what I say. And think about it. What is your X factor? What makes you different? You know, you could be a great teacher. You could be a musician. You could be a sports person. You could be a single parent who's brought up children on your own. What is your X factor? And how are you different? Okay? Our primal instinct is to be and fit into the herd, to try for survival. Okay? For me, step out of that and be and lead. Because you can be a clone of everybody else. For me, I've got one foot in the spiritual camp and one foot in neuroscience. And people say to me, what do you believe, Jim? It's quite strange. You study neuroscience at one of the most prestigious universities in the world, if not the most, but you've also got this background in hypnosis and NLP and energy. Where do you stand? And I always say to them, you know what? I believe science knows too little to dismiss anything, and I also believe we know too much to follow one modality. Let's have an open mind. Let's live with possibilities. That's where I am. I'll uncover every stone to my clients first. There's no ego, okay? So for me, I'm going to give you some stuff today that you can really work on, that I truly believe can make a big difference. It's only millimeters away. I was millimeters away, just tweak a few things here and there, but I learned the hard way. And for me, think of who are your customers? Who knows who their customers are? Yeah? Be very clear, okay? Does anyone work in sales? Okay, we're all in sales. If you're a teacher, you've got to sell your class to the students. If you're a parent, you've got to sell to your children to not do bad things, to do the right things. If you're a therapist, a coach, we're all in sales. Because people buy people. They don't buy a product, they buy you. You are who they buy. They're not buying the modality that you teach, first and foremost. That will come into it when they look. Sourced. I know your customer, and I'm going to do a process shortly interacting called an elevator pitch. Okay? Imagine, if you will, you're in the elevator. These wonderful elevators we've got here with the view of the beach, Eastbourne, beautiful part of the world. And you're in this elevator, and you've got someone who's very influential in the elevator, or just a customer, or potentially someone who can get you into the corporate sector, who can get you a sporting team, who can potentially be a client, and you've got 30 seconds or so to get the message to them before they switch off. And I can back this up with neuroscience that and the way the mind works and how it engages. So you've got a very short time to make a maximum impact with this person, and what you've got to do is some sort of guidelines to look at, it's not exhaustive, is you've got to get them to bite. You've got to get them interested. The hook's got to be there. Think about who you work with, okay? What you deliver, what you bring to the table, okay? how do you quantify your worth? I said earlier, someone pays for a session for me, the value I create for them, whether it's still training in the corporate sector, whether it's a session for someone who rings me up saying, oh, I've got this big job interview, I'm in meltdown, whether it's someone who says, you know what, I can't compete on the weekend, I'm really, really, my head's gone. Whatever it is, the value by doing a session, you'll never see the worth. That investment they pay for a session, if you put it in any other investment, what would you get back? The investment you give to people know your worth. I went to a company once and they said to me, Jim, we like you as a person, we think you're great at what you do, they're bringing you to do some sales training for the staff, that a competitor sort of take a lot of their market share. The only issue is your price, it's cheaper than you. I said, fine, go, get someone cheaper. It don't make a difference to me to survive, to look after my family. I'll drive a taxi for after, just because you know, the hard people to do what it takes, or the factory, I've been there before, I'll walk away. That's my worth. And I said, well, and what I was asking wasn't ransom, it was what I thought was going to take me to do the session, effectively. And as I walked away, I said, you know what? What's the worth to you? Me coming in there at that rate. You carry on the way you are, where will you be? Get someone who's willing to go coming cheaper than me, who hasn't got the same track record, and they might do a better job for all I know, but they might not. So it's about knowing your worth as well. Okay? And that was hard for me. And we're going to talk later in the seminar about breaking beliefs. Because I felt I love what I did so much, and love what I do so much at times, I think, you know, it's not even work. I love it. I'm obliged to help people. But there's got to be a fine line. You burn out. Burn out and broke is no fun, because then you can't do good work anyway. And I've been there. I've been in situations in my life where I've literally lived on the street. It's a horrible place to be. It really is. Okay? I wouldn't wish on anybody. And I've been in places where I've been very affluent. Okay? I'm not saying one is better than the other, but to do good work, you need to be comfortable. You're going to struggle to tell the bills that you've got to pay. If you think no one cares for you, don't pay your bills for 3 months. And you'll see how people do care for you. You get everyone phoning you up, you know, from the phone bill to the gas bill to this. You don't live for free. You've done a big investment. You've come all the way here. And you do loads of stuff and training. It's about the value. And when you're doing this sort of pitch, you're going to look shortly and pair up shortly. Think about that. What's your X factor? What's different about you? What do you bring to the table? Who are you? What's your vision? What's your organization? So what I'd like you to do now is partner up and I want you to, and not going to get it right the first time, but you can practice it. When I first started doing this, I felt so contrived. I thought, ugh, horrible. I really did. I thought, I can't do this. It's not me. Then I realized, you know what? If I wait for the universe to provide for me, I used to meditate like this for hours a day, waiting for the universe, and the universe never dropped a bag of money on my damn head or paid for my bills or nothing like that. What the universe did for me is present the opportunity. But I had to go for it. The law of action. The law of attraction won't get you very far, but the law of action. And I've coached many people who've got the business plan the universe is going to provide. The universe doesn't earn anyone anything. The universe doesn't, you create the meaning. So for me, it's about, okay, the chances will come if you synchronize and go with the feeling. But there's got to be a fine line between, you know what, that's my take on it. If it, whatever you do works good, it's not broken, don't fix it. That's my take on it. So I'm going to have to partner up and have a bash at it, have a go at it. Let's, yeah, sorry.
Can you give an example of
an innovative pitch? Yeah, any specific example that you want, give me something to work with. So
yours.
My innovative
pitch. Yeah, I mean,
yeah.
Middle-aged woman versus a, you know, man dressed well, you know.
Okay, great point. I go to their back of the wall. What's important to me, not what's important to me. What I do, and we'll talk about as we go on the seminar, I don't sell based on what I think is important. It's got to be win-win, and I've got to be right for them, and I've walked away from plenty of jobs that I don't think is a perfect fit. But I'll ask them what they want, what they're looking for, and if I think I can offer what they're looking for, then I'll sort of build around them so I'm flexible. I don't have one size fits all that I don't pitch for everybody I see. And I'll adapt it to the person I'm working with. And that's not sort of being whatever they want me to be, because in my line of work, the customer's not always right in coaching and therapy. I don't tell people what they need, what they want, that's what they need to hear. Okay? And for me, it's about being adaptable. So for me, if I go into a football team, for example, it'll be around someone I've helped in an industry. And I'll be like, okay, I introduced ice baths at a certain football club in League Two, and certain professional players went on to get contracts where they probably wouldn't have got contracts in the past. What's that worth to them? A contract is worth hundreds of thousands of pounds. That's the pitch. I go into business, it might be okay, that's my track record, that's what it's gauged for them. So for me, it's not an exact science, but that's the sort of framework. You know, who you work with, what you bring to the table, what's your X factor? How are you different? For me, it's combining all these modalities, being a lifelong learner for 20-something years, from sports science, physiology, to all these modalities that I've done over so many years with neuroscience. That's my X factor. For me, I walk the talk. I play music and do sports. And I'm out there. And I'm not doing this. I'm in vibration. So I hope that sort of makes sense. And I wish there was sort of one pitch that would work for everybody, but life doesn't work that way. It's like the client. It's tailored, the session. I don't have a script for every client. The client sees me, and I tailor it for where they are to where they want to go. And I don't do anything different here. I meet them in their map of the world, and I guide them to where they want to go. It's their goal. It's not my goal. And if it's not win-win, if it's win-lose, there's no point. If it's lose-win, no point. It's win-win. So for me, it's about practicing and refining it. And what we're going to cover, and I don't want to get sort of bogged down on it throughout the seminar, is knowing how to start fleshing this out more and more. So if you partner with somebody and just give it a go and sort of use those questions as a framework, okay, let's give it a shot. I know it's a bit uncomfortable at first, but it'll come. You know, let's find somebody and have a bash at it, yeah? Yeah.